Good afternoon or good morning, depending on where you're viewing from today, and welcome to the webinar on mushroom whiteness and quality. So I'm Adam Goldwater from Applied Horticultural Research, and I'll be moderating this webinar today. And I'm joined by Dr. Jenny Ekman. Jenny's conducted research on mushrooms for a number of years now. In fact, when she did her honours project on modified atmosphere packaging of mushrooms, that was back in the 90s. And interestingly, in this project that Jenny's talking about today, she actually revisited some of the recommendations she'd made back then. So that's pretty neat to be able to do that. please ask questions during today's webinar. So there's a question slot you'll see on the panel on the right of your screen. So we'll try and answer them as we go, and otherwise we'll come to them at the end of the presentation. The webinar is being recorded, and we'll send a link of the recording out at the end of this to anyone who has registered. And also feel free to share the link with anyone who might be interested. The content for the webinar is from the project MU19005, New Innovations to Improve Mushroom Whiteness and Shelf Life, and that's led by Applied Horticultural Research. The project was funded by the Mushroom Levy, together with matching funds from the Australian Government and managed by Hort Innovation. So over to you, Jenny.
Thanks, Adam. Okay, so welcome everyone. We'll just make sure we're all good to go. Okie doke, so new innovations to improve mushroom whiteness and shelf life. So the aim of this project was to mainly conduct a global review of all the practices that can improve mushroom whiteness. So pre-harvest as well as some post-harvest, but with a particular focus on the growing techniques. And from that, we were to clarify the opportunities for the Australian industry and identify our areas which perhaps need a little bit more work to push them over the line and make them commercially applicable. So in this talk, I'm really just talking on some of the major things that I thought might be of interest to the industry, which have come out of this review. So this is the actual desktop review itself. It's 65 pages long. I'm very happy to send you a copy of this if anyone would like to read the whole thing. But what we're going to talk about today is really a very, very abridged version of some of the key things that I thought were of interest. So, why do mushrooms turn brown? We're going to talk a bit about crop production, nutrition, irrigation method, harvest and post-harvest handling, and the future, breeding, and questions which still remain. So, white mushrooms, I mean, why white mushrooms? Well, white mushrooms are quality mushrooms. Really, quality increases sales and it's going to reduce waste. So mushroom quality, if you put that into one of the search engines for peer-reviewed publications, you find there's a lot of research in this area and it's been increasing, and that's basically down to, where is it? Come on. China. Finally. So in the last 10 years, there has been an enormous amount of research on mushroom quality, agaricus quality this is, not just oyster mushrooms and the other varieties, but agaricus quality, which have come out of China. Now, a lot of these have to do with things which are like washing treatments or coatings, which may not be really commercially applicable to us, but it still gives us perhaps some clues and ideas of things which might be worth pursuing further. So China is really leading the way in mushrooms. So now, why do mushrooms turn brown? Well, for starter, the main thing is physical damage. So here we have a picture of a cell inside a mushroom. You notice that there's a vacuole inside the cell, which is surrounded by a membrane. And inside that vacuole are certain phenolic compounds. So they're sort of antioxidant compounds. Outside, floating around in the cytoplasm of the cell are the polyphenol oxidase enzymes and other enzymes as well. And the whole thing's surrounded by a cell wall. So that's just a basic mycelial cell. So what happens when that cell gets squashed is that internal membrane can rupture And those two things can come together. So here we have these phenolic compounds. They react with the polyphenol oxidase enzyme and form orthoquinones. Now they then go on to be oxidized and turn into melanin. And melanin is the brown product that you see in bruising, in cuts, in, you know, any browning reaction. And that's not just mushrooms, that's avocados, apples, whatever, are all to do with melanin. But it is a particularly narrow process in mushrooms. So the susceptibility of mushrooms to bruising is affected by a whole heap of different factors. Variety, there are big differences between variety. The time after damage. So this reaction is not instantaneous. It occurs over time. So if a mushroom is bruised initially, it might appear to be undamaged. And then after time, that bruise will darken. And so you can see changes up to, I think, 24 hours, 48 hours afterwards, the bruise is continuing to develop. The time after harvest. So mushrooms which have, if they are bruised a day or two after harvest, then that bruise will be more severe than if they're bruised at harvest time, probably due to a loss of structure within the cells themselves as they're starting to become a little bit senescent. Size and maturity. So open mushrooms tend to be more susceptible to bruising than closed caps. And again, flush, so third flush mushrooms, more susceptible to bruising than earlier flushes. Again, probably to do with that membrane integrity. So the other reasons that mushrooms turn brown is due to disease. So bacterial blotch, of course, we are all very familiar with. It's caused by a range of pseudomonad bacteria, particularly Pseudomonas talasi. And the interesting thing about Pseudomonas talasi is that it switches between these two different forms. So there's a smooth wild type, which produces talasin, and that is a toxin which actually breaks down those internal cell membranes. And that is why you get this intense brown colour in infected mushrooms that are infected by Pseudomonas talasi, because you get a lot of melanin form. But the P. talasi is also present in a rough type, non-pathogenic form, and it's just sitting there and it's waiting for the right environmental conditions, whereupon it switches to that pathogenic type. So the factors that can cause that switch are things like if basically anything which causes wetness on the mushroom cap. So low bed temperatures, so slow evaporation rates after irrigation. If the casing becomes a little hydrophobic, you get more splash up and it doesn't soak in and it's that mushrooms stay wet longer. Poor air circulation, mushrooms being colder than the room air, so you tend to get condensation on there. And in fact, if there's just poor nutrition of the mushrooms in total, then you get wetness. And then you get blotch. So that's one of the other key factors why they turn brown. So I tried to summarise those factors and others. So low humidity, pathogens, senescence, high temperatures. Essentially, all of them are leading to membrane disruption. And then you get this contact between the phenolics and the enzyme and oxidation. And before you know it, you've turned brown. So even though there's a whole lot of different causes, they're coming through quite a narrow pathway to cause browning of mushrooms. So crop production and nutrition. A lot of growers, I understand, are using supplements, very common to add to compost to improve yield. Less commonly applied to casing, but they can be. They can be used to stimulate pinning. They can be used to increase yield. There's a whole lot of different reasons. There's been quite a lot of research on the effect of supplements on yield, and a lot of those have shown that they don't affect colour at harvest or in a very minimal way. However, there's a couple of papers that I came across which indicated that they can have a big effect on whiteness during storage. And this particular paper here, it's out of Iran, and they were supplementing the casing with corn or soybean meal. And you can see that even though they were pretty similar whiteness at harvest, the supplemented mushrooms have kept their colour much, much better than the controls. So that is actually a really exciting finding, and I think would be interesting to have a look at how the commercial supplements we're using affect storage quality. I actually tried to contact all of the major supplement suppliers and asked them if they had any evidence for benefits, and not a single one replied. Very disappointing. Yes, Adam, we have a question.
Yes, Jenny, the first question is, could you explain what the whiteness index is that was on that last graph, please?
Absolutely. So whiteness, well, colour is usually measured, maybe I should have put up a diagram. It's usually measured using the a thing called the LAB colour system. So there's the L value, which indicates white to black. And some research papers only use that to measure whiteness. However, there's two other axes. You can think of it like a ball, where you've got white at the top, black at the bottom, and then it goes around blue, yellow, green, and red around the outside. So there's the B value, which can indicate, I think, blueness or redness. No, B is yellow. Anyway, A is redness. Anyway, the point is that you can have a high L value, but if you've still got a lot of yellowness in the mushroom, then that will affect the colour. So the whiteness index is essentially the L value minus multipliers of the A and B value. So it's a lot more sensitive measure of colour than purely using the L value. So it's taking into account whether it's got a bit of a yellow tone or a blue tone and subtracting that from the whiteness of the mushroom. So that's what it is. I should have put a picture on to explain it, but it's a very good measure. So irrigation. So mushrooms are, of course, mostly water. They're really just water in a fancy package. So the quality of the water we're using and how it's applied is going to affect quality and storage life. Too little water, of course, lower RH, high airflow, you get these scaly caps. If there's too much water, cold beds, then you get blotch. So it's really, you know, it's hard to get right. So one of the rules of thumb is that casing should be approximately 60% water by volume. It should also have various osmotic and matrix potentials, which is quite a complex thing, which is explained in the report if you're interested in that sort of issue. But maintaining casing at that sort of water volume is quite difficult, of course, because of drawdown during flushing. And the trouble is that if the casing dries out, then it never regains the same moisture holding capacity. So trying to keep the casing at the right moisture content is really important to get good quality mushrooms. The other thing is that after irrigation, you really need to be aiming to dry the crop within 4 hours. So there are a number of strategies. So before in irrigating, dropping the air temperature to reduce absolute humidity inside the room. And then after irrigating, raising the air temperature, increasing the fan speed a little, and maybe introducing some fresh dry air. With the key things of you need to get the water on, but then you need to get it off the caps. High moisture levels, if you can increase the moisture levels, that can increase yield. But this is often at the expense of dry matter of the mushroom. So they're mostly water. High dry matter can reduce the whiteness at harvest. So this is some work by Barry et al., which shows here we have the dry matter and here we have the brownness. So this, again, this is a complex mathematical thing, which is using the L value, the A value, and the B value and transforming them in order to come up with an index of browning. So as the dry matter has increased, the brown color, so the sum of A and B, has increased. But the thing is that high dry matter does increase storage life. So here we have a different paper, and they've calculated the change in L value, so absolute whiteness. And as you can see, as dry matter increases, this is the brownness after 1 week of storage at 4 degrees. And so the ones with high dry matter have kept their colour much better than the ones which were low dry matter, which have tended to brown during that 1 week in storage. So it's a trade-off, I suppose. Now, the thing about irrigation is that you can put stuff in irrigation water, and there's a lot of proven benefits to that strategy. So the first one I was going to mention is stabilized chlorine dioxide. So this was really pioneered more than 20 years ago, but it's still relevant today. And I mean, it was extremely effective. So in prior to that, a lot of growers had been using essentially bleach to try to control bacterial blotch during production. But stabilized chlorine dioxide is far more effective than bleach because it's active at a wide range of pH. It reacts specifically with these sulfur compounds, so it doesn't just react with all organic matter, unlike chlorine in bleach. It's much more effective against bacteria and spores. So there's lots of papers which show that irrigation with 50 parts per million chlorine dioxide can reduce bacterial blotch, improve whiteness at harvest, and improve storage quality. Now, the thing is about chlorine dioxide, it is already widely used to disinfect drinking water, and it's registered in Australia for use as a sanitizer for mushrooms, for treating water, but only at 5 ppm. And then it can be used to disinfect equipment at 100 ppm. So the 50 ppm irrigation treatment is a little difficult. So our next candidate though is calcium chloride. Now again, this is not a really new idea. This is from 20 years ago, and this is what I came across in my honours thesis. And one of my recommendations was try calcium chloride in irrigation water. But it's still relevant now. So irrigation with 0.3% calcium chloride in solution, once pinning starts, improves whiteness at harvest, reduces susceptibility to bruising, it doubles the calcium content of the mushrooms, and it reduces post-harvest browning. So this top one here, so here we have, again, another measure of colour, L value, whiteness. Maximum L value of pure white is 100. So these are pretty white. Now you can see that in the first flush, there's not a lot of difference, but by the time we get to the third flush, there are major benefits from irrigating with calcium chloride. The other thing, this second graph here, is the calcium content. So again, the first flush, not a lot of difference, but once we get to the third flush, there's a huge amount of increase in calcium content. Now, I don't know if that would be a marketable thing. That's not my area, but it certainly could be a useful thing. So you could see that the calcium is not absorbed directly into the mushroom. It's taken up from the casing because it's not in the outer layers. There's no effect on yield, certainly not significant. And this main improvement in the later flushes. So we got very excited about this, well, me particularly, and I wanted to try it. So we did. So we did a little trial at the Marshall Lawson Mushroom Research Unit here at the university. And we did exactly this. So we irrigated some mushrooms with 0.3% calcium chloride in solution. And then we recorded the colour at harvest, and then during storage, just in a domestic refrigerators that we've got in the lab, in an overwrapped punnet. And see, the second flush, not a lot of difference. First flush, some. Third flush, absolutely. You can see that. So I've used, again, I've used the whiteness index. So it's the L value and the A and B values taken into account. And this is what they look like. So after 24 days, can see a difference here. I think this is the one with the calcium chloride, and that's the control. Second flush, they're all looking pretty ugly, but look at this third flush, like absolutely clear. And so I did a little thing, you know, like you put them all out on the bench and say, guess which one's been irrigated with calcium chloride, and say, oh, that one, that one, and that one. It's like, yep, that's the one. You could see a big difference. So that's quite exciting. So why, if it's so good, why aren't we using it now? And how does it work? So there's a number of theories. It's one is that calcium tends to block the uptake of copper, and copper is associated with that melanin formation and oxidase activity. Calcium increases the strength of cell membranes. So this is what this is a microscope image of cells, of mushroom cells initially, and then they were bruised. This is a mushroom that was irrigated normally with water, and you can see that all, see the vacuoles, those little white areas inside the cells, and you can see how they've just blown out and merged, and it's all turned into a bit of a mess. Whereas in the one irrigated with calcium chloride, it still looks pretty much as it did initially. What's more, these little dark spots here, they're a bit hard to see, but you can't see them in the bruise. We think those are the phenolic compounds. And so in this one irrigated with water, they've reacted and you can't see them anymore. Whereas in the calcium chloride one, they're still present. So the membranes have held, that reaction's not occurred. The other thing is that calcium chloride can kill bacteria, and then you can get additive effects if you combine calcium chloride and that chlorine dioxide or hydrogen peroxide or other things too. So why aren't we using it? Well, I'm not really sure. It's a permitted ingredient in foods by FSANS. It's already added to numerous foods and drinks, particularly preserves, pickles, various drinks, beverages. It's generally recognised as safe by the US FDA. However, the position on whether we can legally irrigate with this product is unclear, and that is something that I believe Judy Allen is investigating with the APVMA even now. So, yes, it's a very interesting product. But then there are a whole lot of other things we can also add to irrigation water. One is e-water. So e-water is becoming very popular with vegetable growers. It produces low constant levels of chlorine and other ions by passing an electrical current through water which contains trace amounts of salts. So it's approved under organics because you're not putting anything in. You're just generating these active ions within the existing water supply. So low levels of chlorine continuously can be quite useful. Plasma activated water is another thing that's a sort of exciting new area of research. It's generating reactive oxygen species in solution, and it can kill bacteria on surfaces. The trouble is it has to be used immediately. It degrades quite quickly. Something I've come across is this CalClear unit. Now it passes, water is passed through a coil. It claims to somehow make the calcium ions more dissolved in the water. The objective is to prevent scale in irrigation system. However, it may also make calcium more available to plants. It's being promoted a lot with hydroponic plant, like vegetable production. It may be worth trying this with mushrooms. Reduce scale, increase calcium availability, might be good. Another option, sodium selenite. So this is a selenium additive to irrigation water. There's been some work which shows it increased whiteness at harvest, increased storage life. The other thing is it increased selenium content in the mushrooms to 60 micrograms per 100 grams. So that is approximately the recommended daily intake for adults. So selenium is widely associated with being an anti-carcinogen, so protective against certain cancers. And a lot of people are deficient in selenium. So 40% of women, 25% of men. Could be a marketing opportunity in the future. Just something worth considering. There's a whole lot of these other things which have been trialed in China particularly. One of them is brassinosteroid, so it's like an extract from brassica plants like broccoli. They're an antioxidant. They're generally recognized as safe because it's a natural product. And you can see here, these are the controls. These are ones which have been dipped in the brassinosteroid And this one here, 3 micromole solution, it seems to have protected it from browning because it's an antioxidant, so it stopped that enzyme reaction. Then we have irrigation method. I'm going a bit over time. Optimizing irrigation, like we said, is essential for good quality. So could we be managing it a little better by using moisture probes? This is what vegetables, fruit, all their irrigation is managed through these moisture probes, but we're not doing that for mushrooms, which is sort of interesting. One of the issues has been that the sensors used for soil are not suitable for use in casing and substrate. However, there are now new sensors that could be more suitable and could be worth testing to see if that would improve results. Another development is this Netafim Mushroom Master subsurface drip system. So again, this is really copying what vegetable production has been doing for years and years and years. Now, it seems like a great idea, like the yield is similar, but the quality is improved greatly. Irrigation can continue during harvest without wetting the caps. So you can keep the moisture content absolutely constant the whole way through the cropping cycle. You could put fertilizer through the drippers so you can fertigate. The claim is that you can reduce the casing material, so the peat, by 30%. So that would be a cost saving, quite significant. There's no bacterial blotch because there's no moisture on the caps. If there's a weed spore in the grow room, well, we're not dispersing it through splashing of irrigation water. The dripper lines can be reused several times. However, as you can see, it is quite complicated. I'm not sure how much it costs, but that would be an interesting thing to examine, like what are the cost benefits of this system? How reliable is it? Can it be used in an Australian context? And I know some growers have been looking at it already. It's only going to be suitable for shelf systems, clearly, but it certainly seemed to have some promise. Moving along, I'm going to go a little over time. Sorry, I get a bit excited about these things. So harvest and post-harvest handling. Temperature, 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 temperature is always the most important thing affecting mushroom quality. The mushrooms, really, to maximize quality, they should be cooled below 4 degrees within an hour of harvest, if you can. Now, just putting them in a room does not make them cold, clearly. Room cooling is slow. You need to space things apart. It's also quite energy inefficient. Forced air systems, where air is actively moved over the product, are much better. But of course, the gold standard is vacuum cooling. And I know a lot of mushroom farms already have vacuum cooling, and you know, it's just the best. It's energy efficient, it's fast. But interestingly, I came across this work here which suggested that the vacuum cooling process reduces enzyme activity inside the mushrooms and hence reduces that browning reaction. So they've got a different browning index here. In any case, the vacuum cooled mushrooms are slower to brown than those which are room cooled, even something not accounted for just by the cooling rate. So that's kind of interesting. The other thing is that once they've been cooled, they've got to stay cold and they've got to keep temperature as evenly as possible. So minimizing temperature fluctuations reduces condensation, reduces moisture loss, reduces bacterial blotch. So in order to avoid these, there's a number of things you can do. So I've put these charts here, which are from 2 cold rooms. They're both set at about 1.5 degrees, 1 to 2 degrees. And they're both running within those set points. However, you can see that this room here is a lot more stable. So you're getting those spikes where the compressor's turning on and off, but not as many as this one. And this greatly affects the humidity inside the room. So where temperature is well controlled, the humidity is running at 90%, approximately 85 to 90%. pretty continuously. However, in the room with poor temperature management, where it's going up and down all the time, even by only 1 degree, you can see the relative humidity has dropped to 80% to 85, and it's going up and down. And every time it goes up and down like that, there's condensation on the mushrooms. And you know where that condensation has come from? It's coming out of the mushrooms. So it's they're losing moisture and getting bacterial blotch. So it's lose-lose. So minimizing those fluctuations inside the room is really important. So minimizing the door opening, using air curtains, getting good insulation, loading directly into trucks. Those sort of things are good strategies. Now, finally, we're coming to a few just novel treatments that I came across. Now, one is fumigation with 1-MCP. Now, 1-MCP was the most exciting thing to happen in post-harvest since we got refrigeration. Seriously. Back, you know, it's revolutionized the storage of apples worldwide. Pretty well every apple you eat is treated with MCP. It's effectively what it does is it blocks the effects of ethylene. It's used at very low concentrations. It's a gas, and it just makes them unresponsive to ethylene. It seems to interfere with some other processes too, but undetectable in the finished product. Use pears, persimmons, broccoli, all sorts of products. Now, I wouldn't have thought of trying it on mushrooms because mushrooms don't emit a lot of ethylene. They're not ethylene sensitive, but these guys did. And the results are surprisingly good. So we could see these MCP treated mushrooms here are really a lot whiter than the controls after 4 and 11 days of storage. So interesting, don't know why, but could be worth a look-see. Another thing is ozone in storage. So ozone, again, it's used to inhibit the effect of ethylene. And, I've copied and pasted there. Whoops. That's not meant to say that there. So ozone is, it's used to control mold spores in the air, and it can control decay on fruits and vegetables. There are new systems which enable it to be used in rooms which have automatic lockouts and monitoring of ozone. And so it can now be used safely, whereas a few years ago it could not. So ozone would be interesting as a treatment to reduce spread of disease in rooms. Here it is. So it helping to prevent bacterial growth. Now, this was some work where they used a high voltage electric field, which generates ozone, treated some mushrooms, electron microscope image here of the way the mycelium are connected. You could see after a period of storage, the controls, the mycelium are starting to break down a little, whereas in these ones that are exposed to ozone, they still look quite intact. And this is the effect on colour that they got. Again, the mushrooms which have been exposed to ozone have stayed whiter longer, which kind of makes sense because it would be controlling bacterial blotch. And reducing activity of those oxidative enzymes. So that sort of makes sense. That was in storage. It would be interesting to try it in a room and see how that went. Now the future, mushroom breeding. So one of the things that really strikes you about mushrooms is this narrow pathway that results in the formation of melanin. There's only a very few genes which are responsible for those browning reactions. So you'd think, well, if I can knock them out, then mushrooms will never brown. And that's what this, you know, maybe this work here has done. They've been looking at all these hybrids and then bruised them. And unfortunately, it's underneath here. This one here is like almost no bruising compared to this one, which has got quite a severe bruise. The other advance is the use of CRISPR or Cas9. So CRISPR stands for this clustered regularly spaced short palindromic repeats. Essentially, it's snip chips, so it snips bits of the gene out. So So it just removes things from the genome, targeted things. So you can decide, I don't like this bit of the gene, and remove it. So you can remove the genes responsible for browning. The US FDA has ruled that the mushrooms, there have been mushrooms bred by this technique. US FDA says they're not transgenic because it's only deleted genes. It hasn't added anything. However, this is extremely controversial. So there are a number of groups who are anti-GM who are campaigning against this and don't want to have these mushrooms available. That has not been commercialized as yet, but something to work. Watch, I think. So these are our questions remaining. Things that I think would be worth maybe looking at further commercially or in a research sense, like additions to irrigation water, e-water, could we market selenium enhanced mushrooms? Would it be worth trying the CalClear system to increase the calcium uptake of mushrooms? Irrigation methods, so those different methods, the effect of commercial supplements on post-harvest quality, ozone, MCP, and then finally, just keeping a watching brief on breathing. So I'd just like to, in closing, acknowledge that we've had lots of input from Tim Adlington in particular, who's just a gem, and Judy Allen, Warwick Gill, Graham Price have all helped with the project, particularly in ground truthing the reported research results and adapting them. And as we said, this project was supported by Hort Innovation using the Mushroom Fund. If you'd like more information or copies of this full document, then please contact me and we might close it there.
Okay.
Oh, there's the last slide. There we go. There we go. That's my dog with a big mushroom, a very white mushroom, though, I would say. So, Adam, do we have any questions?
Yes, I'll just jump in the screen here. So,
okay.
Thank you, Jenny, for your fantastic presentation. I know we've gone a bit over time, so I might just cover a couple of things here.
Mm-hmm.
So, Jeff had a comment. He was surprised about the paper that inferred higher dry matter mushrooms were browner. In his experience, it was converse.
That is quite possible because the results, the published results are very conflicting on this. So for every paper that says high dry matter reduces whiteness at harvest, there's another one that says the opposite.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really difficult. But the one thing that seems to be definitely the case is that high dry matter increases shelf life.
Mm-hmm. So. Another point from Jeff was rather than watering calcium chloride over the product, he's had the same effect by adding calcium chloride at the mixing time. So thinking that might be worth a try.
Yeah, no, that's quite possible because the calcium chloride is definitely taken up through the xylem vessels of the mycelium. It's not absorbed through the cap. And so if it's available in the casing and the water can carry it into the mushroom, mm-hmm. absolutely, that should do really the same thing.
Mm. Okay, question from Mohammed. Do any whitening agents make mushrooms firmer? So in other words, do they increase the weight, the density perhaps?
Yes, well, calcium chloride definitely does. It certainly makes for a denser, firmer mushroom. We felt that even in our little trial at the MLMRU that we thought that they seemed firmer. I don't know about the other whitening agents so much. A lot of them are applied as washes, and so then you're washing the mushroom and so it may absorb some moisture, so, but the calcium chloride, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe the stabilized chlorine dioxide may have improved firmness as well in some of the papers. Yep.
Okay. So we're sort of quite a bit over time. So I might just wrap this up now. But thank you, Jenny, for covering a number of very interesting innovations in increasing mushroom whiteness. And a lot of those will be available in that review that Jenny's produced, and will that be sent out to industry?
Well, yes. I mean, look, if anyone wants to, I mean, it's not for everyone to read a 70-page document, but I'm certainly happy to send out a copy. There's also, I've also prepared a short version of best bets. And so that's only 4 or 5 pages. So if anyone would like a copy of that, then absolutely, I'd be happy to email it directly. And otherwise, I think we're going to make them available through the AMGA website.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And if you have any further questions that you think of later today, then by all means, flick an email through to Jenny and we'll send out the recording from the webinar. So thank you very much to everyone for joining.
Thank you, and sorry to have gone over time.